So what are you making for din-din, Brandy?
I'm making a homemade chef salad.
Homemade chef salad. That's Brandy, my niece, Linda's daughter. She has been very supportive with mother and I, and as has her mother. So it's delightful to have her here, and she's making a wondrous salad. It's so strange to see me without. I almost never look in mirrors, even when I brush my teeth. And when I do these videos and I'm not wearing a hat, I see, man, I'm an old, old man. Look at that. No hair. Not too many wrinkles. Old. Oh, I like being old. That's okay. So I've, started working on what I hope will be an entire collection of stories with Jessica Amanda Salmonson. Jessica is a fantasy novelist, and she wrote a very modern horror novel, an exquisite horror novel called Anthony Shriek. And when I first began writing, when I returned to writing, I took a break from writing, and then I returned to writing. And I was writing a story. At that time, Jessica was editing two small magazines, Fantasy Macabre and Fantasy and Terror. They're just wee, like, chapbook journals. But they were quite wonderful. And so I wrote the first of the new series of Sesqua Valley stories, a story called Totem Pole. And Jessica published that in one of those magazines. And but years before that, I wrote the very first Sesqua Valley story. It was called Oh Christmas Tree. And I submitted it to Space and Time, and Gordon Lindner rejected it. So I let Jessica see the story, and she completely rewrote it. And she made it magnificent. So then I resubmitted it to Space and Time, and Gordon published it. And then Jessica published it in one of her paperback anthologies, Tales by Midnight Volume 2, that was published by Tor Paperbacks. So, to my knowledge, that is the only Sesqua Valley story that has appeared in a commercial book, to my knowledge. And then I wrote, Jessica loves ghost stories, so I wrote Pale Trembling Youth. And I wrote the original version of that story for one of Jessica's magazines, and I sent it to her, and she said, well, it's a good story, but it needs a stronger beginning. Can I work with it? And, you know, she's a famous novelist, so I'm going to say no. So I said, certainly. And not only did she really enhance that story, but then she submitted it to Dennis Etchison for his anthology Cutting Edge. And thus I had my first real professional publication as a writer. And I wanted to return to writing with Jessica, but it just never happened until just recently. I sent her, I want to have a story published in S.T. Joshi's Black Wings Volume 3. So I sent him a story that I wrote with Tom Lynch, which I thought was a good story, but S.T. rejected it. And so I wrote about 15,000 words, I think, beginning of a story set in Arkham. And then I sent what I had written to Jessica. And at first she had a really difficult time finding a way to expand it. She thought it was too, it was a little more than a filler. It wasn't a real story, and she wanted to write a real story, a long story. But then she became inspired, and she wrote the rest of that story, and I have yet to see it. I am really excited to see it. Can't wait to see it. So Jessica is a huge fan of Clark Ashton Smith, and so I want to write with her a story inspired by Clark Ashton Smith. So I've been taking notes in one of my commonplace books. I want to call the story An Occupant of Ruin. Here's a few of my notes. Necromantic flowers, conjured blooms of dead flowers. Jester is a skeletal dwarf and leads people in a ceremony of a dance macabre. There is sand in the forest, and when the main character is going to be a woman, I like having strong female characters in my fiction. And so as she's been kicked out of the village on account of practicing sorcery, which is forbidden. And so she is taken to this haunted woodland and forced into it. In the forest there is gray sand that kind of wraps around her like a cloak. And as because she's crawling through it, she walks and then she crawls. And she's walking toward the ruins of a castle. And the first sight she sees as she approaches the castle is, there's a moat of curiously scented water, and on that water surrounding the castle she sees this dwarf like jester on a raft, and the raft is propelled by cat things, and she climbs onto the raft and looks into the water, and she sees that the sand has cloaked her her nude body, and she is taken into the castle by this skeletal dwarf. And and there are many arch doorways in the castle, and then there is an arched mirror, a standing mirror in a golden arch, which is always for me symbolic of H.P. Lovecraft's The Outsider. And as she stands before that mirror, she sees her body covered with this coating of sand from the evil forest. And then these tall, shadow-like things come to her with ladles or something, and they pour the water over her. And she notices that the water smells exactly like the water of the moat smell. But the water washes the sand from her nude body, and the sand spills onto the floor around her. And then the jester comes in with his skeletal hand. He writes her name in the sand. That's as far as I got. Another idea that I have is that this jester is little more than a skeleton with scraps of skin covering him. And the face is almost completely a death's head. And so in a moment of gratitude, the woman who has been banned from the village places her hand over the face of the skeletal jester, and the flesh of her hand creeps off her and covers the skeletal head of the dwarf, and thus gives him a face. And she has a skeletal hand, just like he does. Anyway, those are ideas playing in my mind. So I am anxious to get to work. I'm going to try and write a beginning of about 3,000 words and then send that to Jessica. So, it's good even just to be thinking about writing. It'll be wonderful when the writing actually begins again. Yeah. And this is what happens to me when I go to events like the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival. I get a lot of acknowledgement for my writing, and it is so delicious to me that I come home from such an event with a real keen desire to do some new writing. So hopefully I will. All right. I'll talk to y'all later. Goodbye, my darling.